good Sunday morning. And welcome to the Feminist and Women's Media Festival panel this morning. I'm really delighted to be chairing this panel. My name is Eng-Beng Lim, and I am Assistant Professor of Theater Arts and Performance Studies here at Brown. I'm multiply affiliated here with Gender and Sexuality Studies, Ethnic Studies, American Studies, and East Asian Studies. So my charge today is to moderate a conversation on borders. Borders continues to be generative and a fraught analytic for understanding transnational productions of culture at the myriad intersections of colonial and national histories, queer and diasporic encounters in the wake of biopolitical and neoliberal capitalist projects. The five fabulous conveners of this media festival, and I want to acknowledge all the hard work that they've done for this absolutely fabulous festival, conceives of this conversation this way. Quote, "This panel is organized around questions of borderization and borderlessness, of sexual formation as it lines up with and against political, socio-economic, and racial bordering. It brings together scholars and practitioners to reflect on the relation between gender, sexuality, and nation-state sovereignty, new forms of capital, labor, and consumption, the status of colonized people within global flows after neoliberal adjustments, and the structures of forced displacement, trafficking, deportation, and the illegalization of human beings," unquote. It's a very provocative set of questions, which I'm sure will generate many, many debates and discussions this morning. The question of borders, both internal and geographic, foreground one of many methodologies for thinking about location in the midst of massive capital flows and population. And the question of how to produce art and how to locate oneself in this really mind-boggling transnational matrix is still something that I'm trying to grapple with. In this regard, I am really excited to be in the presence of three absolutely fabulous thinkers and practitioners, and I would love to introduce them. Before each of them takes 10 to 12 minutes to present some short comments. The first speaker today is Hong An Truong, who is an interdisciplinary artist and writer who lives and works between New York and North Carolina. Her writing on Yvonne Rainer has been published in Performa 09, Back to Futurism, edited by Rosalie Goldberg. Other writing has appeared in Asia Pacific Journal, Southern Exposure, Journal of Politics and Culture, and the exhibition catalog for Dean Q. Lee at the Contemporary Art Center of South Australia. Her work has been shown at Art in General, New York 2009, International Center for Photography, New York 2010, Parsons Aronson's Gallery, New York in 2010, and the list goes on. There's a lot in her CV that's really impressive. Her work is currently showing as part of Artist Film International, which will travel to Istanbul, modern Turkey, Ballroom Marfa in Texas, Whitechapel, London, Parasite in Hong Kong, among other venues. Most recently, her work has been discussed in The Gift of Freedom, War, Debt, and Other Refugee Passages, Duke University Press 2012, by Mimi Nguyen. She's a recent recipient of an Art Matters Foundation grant in 2012. Truong received her MFA at the University of California in Irvine in 2008 and was a studio fellow in the Whitney Independent Study Program in 2009. She is currently an assistant professor in the art department at UNC Chapel Hill. Our second speaker is Mimi D. Nguyen, who is Associate Professor of Gender and Women's Studies and Asian American Studies at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. Her first book, which I know has recently won the Association for Asian American Studies Best Book Prize in Cultural Studies, so congratulations to Mimi, focuses on the promise of giving freedom, concurrent and contingent, with waging war and afterlife, Duke University Press 2012. She's also co-editor with Fiona Ngo and Marion Lam of a special issue of Positions on Southeast Asian American Studies, which was published in winter 2012, and is also the co-editor with Thuy Lin Nguyen Thu of Alien Encounters, Pop Culture in Asian America, Duke University Press 2007. Nguyen was recently named a Conrad Humanities Scholar for 2013 to 2018, a designation supporting the work of outstanding associate professors in the humanities within the College of Liberal Arts and Sciences at the University of Illinois. She also publishes on the prominence of beauty and the danger of intimacy. And finally, our last speaker is Nilita Vachani, who is a writer and filmmaker living in New York and New Delhi. She has directed, produced, and edited three feature-length award-winning documentaries, including Eyes of Stone, Diamonds in a Vegetable Market, and When Mother Comes Home for Christmas. Her first novel, Homespun, was published by Other Press in 2008 and won Forward's Choice Fiction Award. She has worked as an assistant director and script supervisor to Myronair and as an editor on documentary films. Her first screenplay, Banyan, won the Fonz Sad Prize for an emerging filmmaker. She has recently adapted Amitav Ghosh's novel, The Hungry Tide, for the screen. Nilita is an associate teacher at the Tisch School of the Arts, Department of Undergraduate Film and Television at New York University. Please join me in welcoming all our speakers.
Deals with the archive, so there's definitely an overlap in thinking about archives in relationship to Asian American history that's really different than what how it was discussed yesterday. Yesterday, Portia Cobb, a filmmaker, she showed us an image of her father that she found on the internet through, I think, an ancestral website, which I thought was really interesting, just a public website. Because for me, as a Vietnamese American artist who works in the archive, always looking through, national archives around the American War in Vietnam, the process is an act that's always about looking for myself or looking for my family, but actually never seeing oneself. So I thought that, the chances of actually seeing oneself reflected, both literally but also kind of figuratively, I think doesn't happen for someone like me. So I think this is a really interesting distinction, that for so much of Asian American history within the concept of diaspora, archives suggest a concept of the borders as a non-physical space. I'm sorry, I have to read because I'm not very good at just speaking. Scholar Benedict Anderson, in his 1983 book, Imagine Communities, interrogates the idea of a kind of shared identity that is a kind of imagined political community. He's theorizing nationalism specifically, but talking about the possession of citizenship in a nation that prompts the individual to imagine the boundaries of a nation, even though these boundaries don't physically exist. For me, this is useful to think about the kinds of imagined relationships that Vietnamese have across the diaspora. While not constituting a nation, it's really within a context of proliferating media and access to that media and movement across borders that allows for a different production of subject. So So for me, my interest in the photographic and filmic image is through the history of the camera as an instrument of European colonial aggression, a tool used as part of the colonial enterprise. Much of my work is shaped by archival research and what maybe could be called a kind of performative documentary process. So I'm interested in the use of images and their archives in the production of knowledge and how we understand history, the production of how we come to know this history. The development of mass circulation photography went hand in hand with the use of the camera as a colonial technique. The photographic and filmic image was used to map, control, establish difference, creating and perpetuating a positive knowledge of people, of both people and places. Images of the French and American wars in Vietnam were part of the vast flow of information on which the colonial project depended and desired. This established formal and aesthetic conventions of the documentary and ethnographic image. And my work with these archives are really about interrogating these conventions and mining back what is encoded and interrogating the narratives that are told about Vietnam and histories of Asia more broadly. I'm also interested in challenging the hegemony of aesthetics or the regime of the visible. Jacques Rancière, a philosopher who talks a lot about aesthetics, discusses this in his book, The Politics of Aesthetics, what is permissible or allowable to show. He argues that politics is the struggle for equal recognition in the established order. Aesthetics is bound up with this battle because it is the battle over images. Again, what kinds of images are permissible to show? What is allowed to be visible? I'm also interested in how to think through subjectivity, the viewer's subjectivity through those implied in the photographs or moving images that I use. I like to create tension between the indexical, mimetic doubling of the camera by calling attention to the viewer's awareness of her own culturally conditioned gaze. So I'm going to show just a clip from this project called Adaptation Fever, which will be shown in full later this afternoon after the panel. The project it consists of four discrete short videos that actually was originally, it was created as, most of my work actually doesn't exist as single channel, sort of in a screening situation. Most of my work is created with installation in mind, so usually I'm building walls or creating sort of a space for viewing all of the work, and usually isn't narrative in the sense of going from one to the next, to the next, to the next. There's no sort of beginning and end. Most of my work plays on a loop and will play in a gallery or museum space that people can enter and leave at any given time. So that's also a different kind of consideration because there's not really ever a beginning or middle or end. It's always on a loop. So I just keep that in mind. I mean, the way that you'll see it later this afternoon, there's a structure to it, but it also can be seen in that way where you don't necessarily have to get, there's again, not the sort of narrative that you get from beginning, middle to end. So this project, Adaptation Fever, explores questions of memory, history, and archive, continuing to think about subjectivity and addresses questions of spectatorship and audience. The entire project uses archival footage made during French colonialism in Vietnam, so pre-1954. I play with the idea that nostalgia can be evoked without memory or experience, but through the imaginary landscape of images and also by the codependent relationship between the West's present and the others present for that present modernity. And kind of, you know, working with these archival images, I'm really interested in this sort of uneasy tension and division between the mythic and the real past, or as a viewer, our own desire in seeing what we want to see in something like historical footage that already sort of carries a kind of certain nostalgic weight to it. So I'm just going to show just a couple minutes of it, just so you can get a visual and I can talk about it a little bit more.
Sự đau khổ thật là to lớn. Sự đau khổ đang bảo tồn cuộc sống của tôi. Sự đau khổ làm anh nghẹt thở và cái đó bóp nghẹt tôi. Je ne peux pas penser à mon enfance sans penser à l'eau. J'étais entourée d'eau. Mon petit village près de Saigon avait des milliers de lacs, d'étangs, de rivières. Pendant la saison des pluies, je marchais les pieds nus sous la pluie, longeant les bords de rivière dans la nuit.
Tôi luôn biết kể từ khi tôi là một cô bé gái. Tôi không biết tại sao, tôi biết là tôi luôn muốn giúp những người bị đau đớn, những người bị đau khổ. Các trẻ em cũng như người già, người bệnh. Chăm sóc cho họ, làm vơi đi những khổ cực của họ. Giúp họ hiểu được là ở phía bên kia của sự khổ cực đó mà họ đang cảm nhận với thể xác là những gì to lớn hơn. Ngoài thân xác của chúng ta còn có những gì khác to lớn hơn. Thân thể đơn giản của chúng ta, chúng chỉ là xác thể mà linh hồn của chúng ta thở xuyên qua.
J'étais une fille malheureuse, toujours triste, qui voulait toujours quelque chose.
Thời đó thật khó khăn, vì chúng tôi ai cũng đều sợ bị trừng phạt, vì chúng tôi là tín đồ Công giáo. Có nhiều lần chúng tôi không dám đi lễ, nhưng chỉ cầu nguyện ở nhà riêng. Có những lúc, khi chúng tôi có một chút can đảm, chúng tôi lại tụ họp bạn bè và cùng nhau đi bộ đến nhà thờ giữa đêm khuya, tay nắm chặt tay. Chúng tôi cảm thấy an toàn hơn khi đi cùng với nhau.
Il a arraché ma robe et je me suis retrouvée nue. C'était ce que je voulais. Je le désirais plus que n'importe quoi. Je ne cessais de le regarder. Le contraire était impossible. Je voulais disparaître dans ce regard jusqu'à m'anéantir.
This project was finished in 2007. And I was interested in looking at Catholicism in North Vietnam in the context of colonialism to kind of sort of, I guess, sort of tease out a contradictory kind of entanglement of desires. It seemed to me that Catholics living in the North, so at the time, under communism, it was Catholics obviously became Catholics in Vietnam through French missionaries. So I was interested in looking at Catholicism in Vietnam as a kind of impossible image, an incongruous assemblage of disparate identity parts. So Catholics in the North, you know, whether they identified as being communist or not, and how they kind of reconciled that with thinking about their Catholic identity. So for me, the archive and its appropriation implicitly offered a way to challenge the contours of truth and fiction, because archival images cannot escape this mark of history. They are signifiers of themselves, both doubling as truth and fiction, document and reliable evidence. After completing the interviews in Vietnam, I began research looking at documentary footage from that time period. And I was immediately compelled by the two scenes and some of the footage I uncovered, the image of the two boys making the sign of the cross and the image of the woman turning back to look at her. And they became kind of the basis for this first part of the project. So formally, I wanted to look at these films as a series of stills, it's kind of, I think, a kind of photographic approach to the moving image, just sort of repeating the same image over and over again, but also based on the idea of like a disinterring from this sort of historical grand narrative about Vietnam, that these nameless individuals who will never be known apart from these brief eruptions as fragments of intimate evidence assembled at, you know, kind of made the sort of foundation of these dominant histories. So, you know, a lot of the footage is incredibly, you know, like 2 second clips of this footage that I slow down and repeat. So they, in some way, they become like characters that I make to try to understand sort of the enigma that's bound up with their historical mark, but also in the kind of desire that we bring to the image itself. And for me, also doubling the image as a strategy evoked a kind of Du Boisian concept of double consciousness. And by mirroring the two frames so that they stare at each other, but also having sort of the black frame around it, I wanted always for the viewer to be aware of a kind of frame within a frame, as if the frame, as you know, calling attention to the fact that the viewer is already sort of viewing it through another scopic device, which is the film screening or the video projection, and aware of the manipulation, right? Not just having the image sort of and being able to sort of indulge in the beauty of the image, but always being aware of that kind of framing. And again, repetition is a kind of formal strategy to reflect the structure of trauma and call attention to the temporality within the image itself. I wanted to split the female voices and treat them in some ways as the same, but fractured from the same historical circumstances. So the French and the Vietnamese voice, sort of, yeah, the kind of the same voice, but from different points. Evoking kind of different instances of becoming by asking the question, who is I in the face of trauma, and fracturing implicit in speaking that I, playing out the fantasy of the first world and the fantasy of the third world. And by using fictional voices, I wanted to tell the story as a kind of restaging of history, not simply a retrieval, a replaying. So my approach to the work was also kind of aggressive. You notice in people, and sometimes the work doesn't get shown because they want a translation, but actually there is no translation on purpose. There's only these terse subtitles that kind of mark different moments just of this first piece. So there's 4 videos in the whole project, but in this first piece, the translation is treated in a very certain way to place the viewer in a position so much outside that it would feel impossible to not feel some kind of discomfort, the sort of not knowing and trying to sort of read into both the tone, but also the image, and be aware of one's lack of knowing. So the intentional destabilization of the viewer's presumed comfort as unaccountable looking subject is within the framing, but also the lack of translation. And for me, narratives also depend on silence, that which is not spoken. So I focus on these, on gestures in the image and silences, and again, forcing the viewer at least partially outside the narrative, and also interested in sort of depending on who I show it to. Some people can speak Vietnamese and can understand the narrative on the Vietnamese side, or know a little bit of French. So there's always different viewing positions in relationship to the piece. And again, calling attention to that, those differences. But I also wanted the exteriority of the position of the viewer to also be in tension with the lore of the image itself, and you know, kind of the double image in that center, that kind of abyss or profane space that becomes, that is the center of the whole image. There's a kind of repulsion, but also desire to look into. So it's kind of, for me, like thinking about that nostalgic image and our desire for it, but also making it rather somewhat grotesque in certain instances. So I'm going to just show, I would like to end by showing just a couple minutes of a different project that won't show later, but I think is also interesting to think about the concept of borders in relationship to Asia and Asian Americans' histories. It's called A Measure of Remorse, and this is a single channel video that is non-narrative, that has no beginning and end, and usually just gets shown projected in a dark room that plays in a loop. The project was provoked by the life of writer Iris Chang, the author of The Rape of Nanking, which was written in 1998. which brought intense and overdue attention to the Japanese military atrocities committed against the Chinese in World War II. And through this piece, I wanted to think about historical violence and the nature of apology through language, the body, desire, and using archival audio. So the piece uses a recording, an original recording, of a PBS interview between Iris Chang, the Japanese ambassador to the US at the time, Ambassador Kunihiko Saito, and journalist Elizabeth Farnsworth. So it kind of reimagines this encounter that actually, you know, could have never happened, but also is somewhat made strange and made dark by the effect of Iris Chang's eventual suicide in 2004. So I will just end with this and then leave it at that. Oops, wrong one.
History between Japan and China, and to Elizabeth Farnsworth in San Francisco.
President Jiang Zemin of China went to Japan last week in the first ever state visit to that country by a Chinese leader. Almost from the beginning, the past intervened. China wanted a written apology from the Japanese Prime Minister for his country's actions in China.
Now, as to your question, the Prime Minister expressed feelings of deep remorse and offered apologies both to Korean President and President Jan. And the ways or means to do so may have been
the Japanese people are genuinely interested in coming to terms with their past. And the resistance to having a written apology, I think, just adds to the distrust that already exists between the two countries.
Mr. Master, we should explain that the Korean president was in China. He was in Japan. He was in
I don't see any difference between these two treatments.
In other words, the verbal apology is just as important, that's what you're saying?
Oh yes, and I wasn't aware that Japanese government ever promised a written apology to the Chinese government. I wasn't aware about how much it had been We apologized on many occasions, including a joint communication in 1972 between China and Japan.
So the piece is about 9 minutes long and kind of, again, it's non-narrative, but uses the audio interview between the conversation between the three people and sort of goes around in a kind of loop trying to get at what is the nature of apology through language. So the visuals really focus on sort of a body relationship, a physical relationship that's juxtaposed against sort of the struggle to understand what apology is through language and how something like an apology that serves as an act through performing the spoken act of saying an apology, but sort of the impossibility of language to actually ever account for that kind of trauma. So, all right, thank you.
So I want to thank the organizers for inviting me to be on this panel. I'm super excited. I'm sorry I couldn't manage to come earlier, but I'm hoping to catch a lot of things today. So in my brief comments today, I want to return to something that I started thinking about when I was writing The Gift of Freedom, but I didn't get to, I really want to think about more and we'll see where it goes. Goes anywhere at all, but I want to suggest something about the graphical or figurative representation of time as a line and as a border. The inventor of the timeline, the first timeline, was published in 1765, and it totally blew people's minds that you could arrange graphically arrange a sense of time in this way. So the inventor of the timeline, Joseph Priestley, argued that although time is itself is an abstraction that may not, quote, be the object of any of our senses and no image can properly be made of it, yet because it has a relation to quantity and we can say a greater or less space of time, it admits of a natural and easy representation in our minds by the idea of a measurable space, and particularly that of a line. The timeline, which then allows us to imagine, he argued, the whole of history is before us, end quote, is a graphical description of progress, which then in the history of the forms of empire presumes to predict for racial colonial others their futures knowable as the moderns' past. So in this work that I do and I'm still doing, I'm interested in thinking about transition and timetable, which are promised at the start of any military action in the United States engages now. So according to this kind of assurance, the military strike and the occupation will usurp illegitimate powers for a limited amount of time in order to restore a legitimate power, right, a regime, following a period of transition from U.S. rule, and that there will be an end to such rule that is calculable according to a timetable, right? So we can hear this kind of language unfurling all the time in terms of how the United States describes its U.S. its occupations. So some part colonial inheritance and some part neoliberal innovation, the calculations and calibrations involved here are numerous and intertwined through their shared forms of liberal measure. In predicting and affecting the end and the beginning, transition and timeline help us to consider liberal war making, which is a governing through freedom, or its promise, as the development of capacities, right, the idea that, you know, the United States will help Afghanistan or Iraq develop the capacities for self-rule, and the intensification of power as it is bound to the passage of time. Drawing on the colonial structures of race and drawing on structures of race and coloniality, including a linear evolutionary concept of time that is deterministic and theological, it follows a line. Transition in its idealistic form refers to the interval between then this presumably illiberal or these presumably illiberal or incomplete forms of sociality and government and the advent of what comes after on the clock of human progress. And yet transition does not actually mean the end of empire, though it does announce itself as such, but is instead its extension into the future. So think about the drawdown of US troops and other coalition forces in Afghanistan that is scheduled for this year, 2014, does not actually mean the end of an imperial presence, and follows from the Obama administration's shift to special operations forces conducting instead kill and capture missions, and new, more permanent infrastructure of ground support for these and drone wars well beyond this deadline for the drawdown. So that in 2010, the NATO Secretary General cautioned, quote, we need to be clear about what transition means and doesn't mean. Transition means that Afghan authorities take the lead and we move into a supportive role, but it doesn't mean a rush for the exit, end quote. So that I want to think about this idea of transition as both this kind of a representation and also the name for the intervention. Facilitating between liberal government as a thing that can be given and liberal governing as a kind of disciplining. So that transition might describe other processes or procedures besides war, of course. Immigration and assimilation apparatuses, refugee encampment and resettlement, welfare to workfare, microfinance and development programs, facilitated, organized by NGOs, so on and so forth. Whatever form it takes, transition, I think, unfolds not as the achievement of freedom or liberation for ourselves or for those benighted others for whom freedom must come from another, but as an intensification and proliferation of power. As Foucault put so well, quote, the fact of living under forms of power, including biopower, the fact of living was no longer an inaccessible substrate that only emerged from time to time amid the randomness of death and its fatality. Part of it passed into knowledge's field of control and power sphere of intervention. So I want to think about transition as that name for that passage from one regime or stage to another, which is rationalized as the better administration of life, to which liberal government links increased capacity in economic or administrative terms of utility and efficiency with increased government in political terms of control and regulation, describing the imperial form of the gift of freedom and the debt it demands from the other to whom freedom must come. Transition thus belongs to a calculative infrastructure that borrows from colonial measures, and accelerates, rescales, and refines these measures with new instruments for power. That is to say, transition produces the measures and the means by which racial, colonial others be given to diminish, but never to close distance between anachronism and history proper, while allowing liberal powers to appear to be other than imperial and predicting the end of its own rule. In other words, it produces a border disguised as a timeline unfolding between us and them, between our past and their future. So in my book, The Gift of Freedom, I close with the reading of Explosions in the Sky, Dien Bien Phu, 1954, which is one part of a multi-channel video series, an installation by Nguyen Truong, called Adaptation Fever for 2006-2007. I'm not gonna show the video, you'll see it later, but I'm gonna describe it briefly. It's only 3 minutes long. It's a black and white video featuring archival film of exploding ordnance belonging to the French forces at Dien Bien Phu in Vietnam, edited, which is a decisive battle where the French colonial forces, in trying to retake Vietnam, failed spectacularly. So it's kind of this imagined to be this decisive moment in the end of French colonial rule in Vietnam. So these images are edited to coincide with the synthesized beat of a bilingual cover version of the 1964 Simon and Garfunkel song, The Sound of Silence. Speeding up and slowing down the succession of blasts over these 3 minutes, Explosions in the Sky then ends in darkness, right, my old friend, and captions seeming to mark a timeline, Dien Bien Phu, 1954, and Hong Antung, 2006. But instead of a timeline, Truong produces a palimpsest. Instead of a sequence of relative positions along a timeline, she locates the wartime past as the continuous unfolding of our present. Editing is a practice of establishing human actions and passions in time and space. It's always a discourse about things, but also about something, about those things as an example of a linkage between the object at hand, a reel of footage, a cover song, and a principle under review. It is, in other words, a practice of transition, which Truong uses to undermine other transitions as the premise of liberal war. Explosions in the Sky disrupts the chronology of world historical homogenous time to bind together French colonial violence and American liberal promise. That is, in the coupling of found footage and cover song, both distinguishes the claims of difference between these scenes of power and also undermines them. Remembered as a decisive battle and a comprehensive defeat of a colonial power, Dien Bien Phu, 54 is the image event that denotes the periodization of forms of Vietnamese sovereignty and foreign imposition. Exploding ordnance conveys to the viewer a conventional image of ruinous subjection, and yet in its reference here, Dien Bien Phu, 1954, comes to light, though only briefly as a flash of danger, as we might say after Walter Benjamin, as an ineffectual class of action for establishing supremacy. The soundtrack provides the reason for these transitions between scenes and between regimes. American singer-songwriter Paul Simon penned The Sound of Silence in the aftermath of the November 22, 1963 assassination of U.S. President John F. Kennedy. Originally performed by folk music duo Simon and Art Garfunkel, The Sound of Silence registers a moment in which the ascendancy of freedom's empire is interrupted. Its lyrics bespeak absence and alienation, suppression and frustrated connection. Quote, people talking without speaking, people hearing without listening, people writing songs that voices never shared, no one dared. In Explosions in the Sky, the uncredited cover version Truong uses alternating verses in English and Vietnamese functions as a metonym and a substitute for the US empire. But The Sound of Silence promises nothing certain about the future that might follow. Progress, it suggests, may be indistinct from paralysis. Its pairing with the found footage of artillery fire, labeled again Dien Bien Phu, 1954, the English lyric, when my eyes were stabbed by the flash of a neon light, it split the night, is especially devastating because the future promised by modernity's forces becomes inseparable from this past. So that the song and the footage together suggests that the passage of time, the idea of the timeline that moves us forward, that produces a border between then and now, that the promise that promises transition is powerful, but also underwhelming. Everything changes and nothing does. In this regard, the viewer's contact with these objects, found footage and the cover song, also renders an ephemeral and intimate experience with timeliness. From this vantage, both image and sound are retroactively charged with meanings that cover, in its multiple senses of masking, but also repeating an assemblage of perceptions and fantasies about the past as a distant colony, for instance. There are no people pictured, but bodies do populate this video as implied by these objects' exchange. Someone shoots and someone else dies, though there is no record here of the dead. Someone calls out and someone else listens. In this instance, that someone else is hung out. Hong An Truong in 2006, who then draws the viewer into hearing distance to return to this past in our present.
Okay, I wanted to thank the organizers as well. I've had a very interesting couple of days. I discovered a film yesterday, which is 100 years old, that I didn't know existed. And some very interesting panels. I've learned a lot. Thank you for inviting me. I'm not going to be showing anything because my film is right after this at 2 o'clock, so I'm really hoping you're going to stay and watch when Mother comes home for Christmas. What I wanted to do here was Eng-Beng introduced the concept of borders, and I wanted through the telling of stories, through the sharing of narratives, cross certain borders in our understanding, I hope. Just now, you know, this Malaysian flight 370 has just vanished off the face of the earth. Now it's been 10 days. And it's pretty extraordinary to think that in this day and time, when with all our technology, an airplane can simply vanish across borders. One thing that struck me about this flight was how the fate of two passengers moved in 24 hours from being potential terrorists to being ordinary victims like anybody else. And I'm talking about the two Iranians on the flight, two young men who were traveling on forged passports. And so immediately, because they were Middle Eastern, forged passports, flight vanishes, they're terrorists. And then of course it turned out that they were in some sense twice victimized because they were part of this human smuggling chain, and each of them had paid $8,000 for that passport, supposedly to the land of freedom, which was going to be either Germany and Copenhagen, Denmark. And instead, they bought this flight. The mother of the 19-year-old is waiting in Frankfurt for her son, thinking he's going to come into a new life, and he's gone. But our conception went from somebody being a terrorist to, you know, them being as tragic a victim as anybody else. So I wanted to, in my paper, talk about the migrant worker, talking about smuggling across borders, and talking about the narratives of some of these women in particular. The person you would meet in my film, I hope you will stay and watch the film, is Josephine Pereira. She's a domestic worker from Sri Lanka,
who was smuggled her way out of the Middle East into Southern Europe. And when we meet her in the film, it's the early 90s. She's living and working in Athens, Greece, as a nanny. And she's taking care of a two-year-old child named Isadora. When she left Sri Lanka 10 years previously, she left behind three children. A two-year-old, exactly Isadora's age, a seven-year-old, and a nine-year-old. And now, 10 years later, she hasn't seen them in 10 years. They are 12, 17, and 19. I want to rewind the clock back to the 10 years previously, in 1983, when Josephine was living in Sri Lanka. Why did she go abroad? She was abandoned by her husband with three small children, and her husband, after he went off with another woman, didn't give her any financial support and was not interested in his kids. Josephine, if she had no options, would have stayed on in Sri Lanka and been a nanny to some richer household. She would have taken care of the kids of others. And she would have earned probably 1,000 rupees a month, which would be about $20-$25 at the time. The reason she didn't do that was an opportunity came her way. A new government had come into power in Sri Lanka in 1977. They were the United National Party. And they had a very novel way of dealing with the country's problems of unemployment, underemployment, and inflation. And that was, get the women out of here, the unskilled laborers, get them out, export them. There's a lacuna in the world, the other richer countries that need the labor of women, let's send them out. They're going to be leaving husbands behind, small children behind, families behind. They'll send all their money back home, and Sri Lanka will become a bank deposit for foreign exchange earnings. It was a brilliant idea, it worked. Suddenly, as Josephine tells me, the way the story in her words was as follows. She was in her village, and these cycle vans would drive in with loudspeakers, and they would say, go abroad for 2 years, make lots of money, come back, build your children a happy home. From village to village, these recruiters would come. They would come into village homes, talk to the women, convince them to go abroad. It was a very interesting time. Borders suddenly opened for them. It wasn't just a physical and territorial border. It was also a border of the mind, borders of the imagination. How could a young woman leave behind her husband, her home, her small children? She had been taught never to do that. What was the definition of being a good mother? Was to be there with your kids. However, the logic was now reversed. She could be a better wife, a better mother, a better homemaker if she went abroad. Worked for a few years, made a lot of money, and then her family could really enter a new life. These women were categorized as unskilled. They had a very rudimentary education. Like Josephine, she was a dropout, middle school dropout, grade 5. They had never heard of Bahrain, Kuwait, the UAE. They had no idea what awaited them there. But they had all the assistance from the government. The recruiters came, got their passports made, got them jobs, contracted them to the Middle East, and actually got their tickets paid as well, because the family, the host family, in the country would pay for your ticket. So, you know, you had no expenses really. So that's how Josephine Pereira, the character in my film, ends up going abroad on a 2-year contract to Kuwait in 1983. Once she gets there, like all of them, her passport is taken away, because after all, the family has paid for her to come, and they want to, she's bonded until the 2 years pass, and she's sort of paid for the fare and everything else. So she realizes she can't change her mind, she can't go back home now. Also, she can't go and look for her job elsewhere in Kuwait. She's literally bonded labor. 7 days a week, working at least 100 hours a week. Salary was $100 a month. And you'd be surprised to know that the salary did not change over a period of 20 years. It was $100 a month. When I was doing the research in Sri Lanka, this was in the early 90s, 70%
of Sri Lanka's employed female force, that is women who earned, were working as housemaids abroad. There have been quite a few horror stories about the Sri Lankan housemaids in the Middle East. You might have heard about an incident that took place about 12 years ago. This woman died in Kuwait, actually. Her body was sent back. Her family suspected foul play. They ordered an autopsy, and in the autopsy it came out that all her internal organs were gone. So she was part of some kind of smuggling organ, live organ chain. There was a more recent incident of a woman just 2 years ago who was beheaded publicly in Saudi Arabia because a baby she was taking care of, choked to death. And she was accused of murder, even though she claimed that the baby had choked as an accident. There are, at the moment, 45 foreign housemaids awaiting execution in Saudi Arabia right now, today. They have very little recourse to legal help. They don't even understand the legal proceedings because they don't understand the language. It's ranging from a woman runs away from an employer and she's accused of theft. She doesn't respond to the employer's sexual advances, and she's accused of unnatural crimes such as fornication. So there are a huge number of stories of abuse. But my film is really about a success story because Josephine Pereira was managed to successfully run away from Kuwait. She paid the human smuggling chain $4,000 at the time. She is working in Athens, Greece when I meet her. She is very happy with her family. They take good care of her. She's earning $500 a month. She loves the little infant who's in her care. So where is the problem? I saw the problem in many different ways in her. First of all, she hadn't seen her children. And she was just writing to them, and they were writing to her, and borders were being crossed in very in ways that were not based in reality. She had this vision that they were all very well looked after by her sister. And as I discovered when I went to Sri Lanka and I met her children before she did, two of her three children were actually living in orphanages, and their mother didn't even know it. She was sending money every month, thinking one of her kids was in an exclusive boarding school and he was actually in an orphanage in a dumping ground. There were other strange signs in Josephine. She never talked about her time in the Middle East because she had illegally escaped, so she didn't want to go there. But there were strange things that would emanate and to tell me about her past. For instance, she had this fear of watermelons. She shuddered every time she saw a watermelon. And Greece, in the summertime, was full of the juicy fruit and everybody's eating watermelons. So I asked her at one point, why don't you like watermelons? And she said, well, in Kuwait, in the 4 years she was there, they gave her very little rice to eat because rice was expensive. But at every meal, there was a slice of watermelon. And so she just couldn't bear it anymore. She might have forgotten those memories, left them behind, but that side of the watermelon would bring it all out. There are a lot of other very subtle forms of abuse that, that came out in the stories of the women I spoke to in Greece. Sri Lanka is has one of the highest literacy rates in Asia. And so all the housemaids, like Josie, had at least started in class 5 or 6. They were all literate. They could read and write. But when they were working in the Middle East, they were not allowed to read newspapers or magazines or novels. Often they were not allowed to even write home or receive letters. And why? Because their madams were often completely illiterate. In these Islamic societies, a lot of the madams had never been allowed to go to school. So how could your servant read when you couldn't? So they were not allowed to read. So there were these forms of control and abuse which I heard from the women again and again. Another was that their identities were altered to suit the host family. So if you were Christian and your name was Maria, or or if you were a Hindu and your name was Damini, your name would be changed to say Rizwana. You would be given an Islamic name, an Islamic identity. And some of the repercussions of this was something like, you know, Maria told me this. Her family called her from Sri Lanka to speak to her, and they said, can we speak to Maria? And they would say, there's no Maria here. And the phone would be put down, you know, they'd hang up. So it's these forms of control, these forms of manipulation and abuse that I heard, you know, even from the successful stories of women who had escaped. Borders also suggest barriers. Borders are not just something you cross, they are limitations that inhibit you. There were multiple borders for domestic workers, linguistic borders, cultural, racial, ethnic. Josephine, a Sinhala speaker working in Greece, could barely communicate with her employers who did speak some rudimentary English, but there was no scope for her ever to assimilate in the country. This is a definite preference too on the part of the employers to hire young married women with children. This prevents the domestic worker from marrying and settling abroad. And for the home country, it's an assurance that with young children at home, the migrant will save everything and send all the earnings back home. Filipino housemaids in Greece were considered white compared to the Sri Lankans, and they were therefore perceived to be cleaner. Filipino housemaids got jobs a lot easier than Sri Lankan housemaids did. Sri Lankan housemaids got jobs easier than the Ethiopians did. It was all a matter of color. Asian women were considered more nurturing, more maternal than African women. They got jobs easier. It's incredible, actually, the levels of barriers and borders. So very often the women would pay to get their information changed on their passports. If they could somehow call themselves Christian rather than Muslim or Hindu, they'd have a better chance of getting a job in a Christian home where they felt they would be treated better. There are borders too regarding masculinity and femininity. Josie, like other domestics, had exported her gender functions across borders. She had become a provider to her children, taking on an essentially a male role. She was a mother to the Greek child, and her tactile relationship with the 2-year-old Greek child is very much there in the film, but her own relationship with her 12-year-old back home is stern, father-like, because she has completely missed his growing years. In a final scene of the film where she plans her daughter's marriage, because she does get back to Sri Lanka while we are filming, I chose her specifically because she had managed to get a work visa and she was going to go back. So I could see what the state was of her children whom she left behind 10 years ago. So in one of the final scenes of the film, she's taken on the patriarchal role completely because she arranges her daughter's marriage and talks about money and dowry, which normally only the man does. She is empowered by her being abroad. She likes to earn, she likes to spend, but somewhere along the way, she's lost a sense of emotional sustenance. Ultimately, no assimilation is possible in the host country, where you are always a guest worker. What happens when you turn 50 and nobody wants you? You've crossed many other borders, yes, but you are no longer the wife or the mother you once were. Marriages dissolve, the men take up with other women, and the children, once you stop sending the money back home, don't really want you. They don't really know you. You weren't there for them in their growing years. You weren't there for them when they had a crisis in their adolescent lives and wanted you there. So borders change again for the women once they're 45, 50, 55. That's when they go back home. But home has been redefined once again. Home has been inevitably changed. Thank you.
I want to thank three panelists for three really very provocative presentations, a very, very rich archive and set of meditations around human dead bodies, archival apparitions, indentured servitude to capitalism, the illegality of time, configured as a linear development through transition, the apparatus of abuse, and the pathologies of colonialism regenerated in new guises. I think there's so much that the three panelists have brought on the table in terms of thinking about the representation of borders as experience, and whether it is in terms of a set of critiques using mimetic doubling or loops to try to think through the incoherency of temporal arrangements that colonial heteropatriarchal projects are predicated on, which their logics are predicated. So I guess I want to begin by just thinking through this really complex set of ideas that have been brought to the table around borders, and to find out how each panelist is thinking about each other's work. I know there's some kind of interface already between Mimi and Hong An. And I was wondering about the ways that the panelists might be able to talk to each other, in terms of thinking about the different sites that you visit, the different kinds of representational logics that you bring in your art making, and also in terms of your critical idiom for thinking about borders, whether it is through histories or through art making or through a set of readings that you bring to American imperialist projects. Just wondering if if you wanted to respond to each other's work and think about what kinds of questions or ideas have sparked during this presentation.
Actually, I have to still discover their work. I don't know their work, so I'm looking forward to discovering.
Yeah, aside from just seeing the description, but we were talking how we were both missing each other's work also. Yeah, so we actually haven't seen each other's work very much. But I also feel like our approaches are really different. I mean, I think it's really different to think about, to make a linear, not a narrative film over, it sounds like, how long did you work on that project?
Well, I researched it over a few years with a lot of different women, but the actual shoot for this is over 8 months.
Okay, yeah, which is really different than my process. Mm-hmm. So even just sort of thinking about materials and, approaching the subject matter, I think is really different. I mean, in terms of like being, invested in storytelling, I'm always kind of working with stories that are already told in some ways. I'm always kind of remaking or challenging stories that are out there, which I think is a really different thing than, telling stories that need to be told, which is, what Nilita is doing. So I think it's just a different approach to storytelling as a form.
Mm-hmm. So just very curious about thinking about borders as a way to organize the work and your thinking, and wondering if that is indeed the kind of episteme or analytic that you are using, since a lot of what you are talking about have transnational implications, and I was wondering if the idea of border is something that's really central to how you configure your critique or your thinking, or is that just one of many methodologies that you bring to think about the issues at stake for you?
It's for everybody.
Yeah.
Well, I'll start. A lot of my work has to do with like definitely the first book, The Gift of Freedom, and then the second project, which is called The Promise of Beauty, is thinking about how certain kinds of distinctions get made between places that have freedom and beauty and other places and persons that are imagined to not have it or not have access to it, don't have the conditions under which they can cultivate freedom or beauty and so on and so forth. So, and these are definitely sort of like, these are definitely kinds of borders that are drawn, right? I mean, so, you know, in the Promise of Beauty project, I'm looking back to, a very obvious reference, which is Immanuel Kant. He wrote a book, I can't remember the name because I can't remember names or dates or anything, which is why I'm not a historian. But he wrote a book, and a part of it was on, national characteristics of the sublime or the beautiful or something like that. He talked about how each nation had like its own distinct form of beauty that was either immoral or corrupt or, noble but savage and so on and so forth. So the idea of how to map where certain place, like the idea of mapping out where freedom lives, where beauty is able to flourish, is a long colonial imperial project, which I'm interested in thinking about. And definitely when we think about that in terms of how and when those maps of where freedom and beauty are imagined to live and to flourish, and how they then are also converge with, wartime projects, mm-hmm. right? Efforts to then bring to those people, mm-hmm. who are imagined to linger without it. It's a really fascinating set of layers. Mm-hmm. So I don't know if that really answered your question.
So I wasn't particularly thinking about borders when I was making the film. I was thinking about it only in the context of this particular panel, but just something that might be relevant, which I felt as a filmmaker. When I was working in Athens and working with Josie, I felt that I too was taking away language from her, because she is not an English speaker. And so when I was trying to get her to talk and to tell her story, I was forcing her to speak in English in a language which is not her own. And so in some sense, I was also taking away her power, linguistically. And so it was, for me, it was a big challenge. How do I tell her story when she and I don't share the same words? I came up, I knew that once we were in Sri Lanka, she would be speaking with her family, she would be speaking in her own space, and language would be there. So I would work with an interpreter, but Josephine would be empowered by her language, but in Greece she wasn't. And I was actually part of that whole system where she couldn't really speak to me, so I had to find new and novel ways of telling her story so that the audience would be connected with her.
I think for me, I do think about borders, but I think about it more in terms of space. A lot of my work deals with histories of Asia, but also intra-Asia history. But always from a perspective as an American growing up in the U.S., of having that perspective and having to understand how Asia is perceived by the West. So, and trying to challenge a kind of spatial coherency that I think the West sort of perceives as sort of Asia as this block, and trying to sort of tease out various histories and complications and fractures within a kind of like monolithic sort of understanding of Asia, I think, from the West. So for me, it's I think about borders in terms of space in that way. And also, the fact that, coming from the US, I'm always just thinking about perceptions of Asia, mm-hmm. and what what are the kinds of ways that the US, particularly in the US narratives, kind of create, you know, how they sort of imagine certain types of borders around Asia. And I think about it especially also with the way that I think about in the way that my work sort of plays out, dealing with installation. A lot of it is about space and trying to place the viewer in a certain kind of relationship to the work that I think does have to do with kind of borders, like, you know, kind of physical but sort of emotional or psychological border to what they're saying.
I think this might be a good time to open up to the floor if people have questions for the panelists. Yes.
Thanks so much. That was such a rich, really rigorous panel. I was also fascinated, like Eng-Beng, by all the kinds of relationships and connections that are emerging among the three different papers. And two questions that I wanted to ask about, just so that I could hear the panelists respond to each other's projects a little bit more. The first one has to do with the kinds of relationships between Nilita's and Hong-An's works. I was really interested in all of the kinds of aesthetic and formal differences between your approaches to documentary, how Hong-An, you're always kind of foregrounding the materiality of the medium in order to think about questions of borders and identity. I think you described it as your photographic approach to moving the medium. Fascinating. And Nilita, I'm first of all really, really looking forward, just greatly anticipating watching your film this afternoon. Your description of it was incredibly compelling. And I'd love to hear you talk a little bit more about your kind of relationship to your documentary subjects and the stories you're representing as a kind of film editor and a documentary ethnographer, and how, you know, what sort of visual and editing strategies you use to organize your representations of these stories. And also between Nilita and Mimi, I was fascinated by your provocation to think about how borders get disguised as timelines. And that question was really lingering in my mind during your presentation as well, when you were kind of talking about how the devastation of displacement across borders through these various false opportunities become, you know, increasingly devastating over time and through duration. So I'm just thinking about temporality and aesthetic strategy and documentary representation across all three papers.
You know, in all the films I've made, I've actually always sort of edited on my own later on, and the subjects of my films have never been involved. This was a different. This was different because I was actually editing in Greece, and so I felt it was an opportunity for me to share the film with Josephine while I was editing it. And there were a lot of things in the film that I thought she would be really bothered by. You never know how a film is going to affect someone, you know. You make it with the best of intentions, and all the scenes where I thought she would have some problems were all actually in Sri Lanka, because, you know, here's this woman who hasn't been with her kids for 10 years, and now she's going to go back for 1 month. That's why it's called When Mother Comes Home for Christmas. She's literally there over Christmas. And there's all this anticipation, both on her side, on the side of her kids. And of course, nothing is as is. You know, it turns out to be like any get-together that, you know, we have on Thanksgiving, for instance, where families get together, and it's all about bickering, and it's all about resentments, and it's all about, you know, wanting to get the hell out of there as soon as possible. So that's what we sort of realized, that, you know, here is this much, much, much awaited visit, and then what happens? And so I was so concerned that, you know, she would get upset about some of the things that were said, and that are there in the film, which I won't go into details. Most of you haven't seen it, but you'll see it in the film. And so it was really strange to me when I was showing her the film, and there are all these very, very intimate, intense moments from Sri Lanka, and nothing seems to bother her in terms of representation. And then she says to me, you know, that this, I'm really, really upset with one scene and I want you to remove it. And I had sort of said to her that if something really bothers you, I'm willing to talk to you about it. And the scene that really, really bothered her was, in my mind, the most innocuous of
scenes which I didn't even think twice of. And this is just a party in Athens where she and her Sinhalese friends are hanging out with some Pakistani guys in somebody's house. And you know, they're sitting there with beer around them and they're chatting. And she was so appalled that she was in a frame where she's here and there's a glass of beer there. And so it's the beer is being associated with her. And she said, what are they going to say back home? In terms of, you know, you're just out there having a great time and you're drinking and you're mixing around with men. And she was so upset by that cultural perception of her, which I didn't even see, and nobody that I showed the film to did, that I actually threw out, I removed that shot, then I couldn't make it work, and actually that scene never made it in the film. So it's just, it's very, you know, just thinking in terms of even borders and what is a border for you, that there, for her, I had crossed a line somehow, which I would never have dreamt of.
See if I can think about what you were mentioning. So I'm going to talk about just what you were saying about the like a photographic approach. I think because for me, I was actually trained as a photographer, so it's easier for me to see things in still images for some reason, and I think that's why all of my work is typically very slow. Images come very slowly, I don't know why. Or I slow things down, or there's just not much that happens. I like really long takes, which I think, again, as a documentary, as someone who's really invested in storytelling as a kind of principle, but really trying to challenge conventions of storytelling in order to sort of reveal the ways in which naturalized conventions of storytelling actually try to make things coherent. And I think I'm always trying to make things incoherent and maybe, and also non-homogeneous in terms of the temporality from beginning to end. And I also really love that idea of like a border unfolding as a timeline, because for me, my work oftentimes is trying to challenge a kind of linear progression of time and trying to think about multiplicities of time or things happening at the same time to try to challenge our present notions or how we understand the present that's in relationship to the past and the future, but how those things are kind of, the way that we bookend those typically in storytelling, I try to challenge that notion of how we understand the future or how we understand the past through a kind of narrative, those narrative conventions. And so I think for me, I approach the formal aspects as always a kind of reinterrogation of narratives that already exist. And so I kind of always start backwards. I always start with a story that's already been told and then try to deconstruct it. And usually through the medium that was already given to us. So for example, with that audio piece, you know, that it's, you know, I use using that I mean, with the Measure of Remorse piece about Nanking, using that audio as a kind of that piece of the story and then trying to deconstruct it backwards. You know, I have other work that has dealt with Palestine and Israel and the and Resolution 181, which is the UN resolution which actually partitioned Israel and Palestine into a Jewish and Arab state. That I use that the UN interviews, the UN speeches that argued for or against the partitioning as a kind of marker or a starting point for that story, and then deconstruct it through reperform the speeches in relationship to other things happening at the same time. So I think what I'm trying to say is that I kind of use material as its own form of storytelling, the archival materials, whatever form it takes, and then I kind of deconstruct the story from that point. Because I think for me, it is, you know, there are so many stories that are already told, and I don't feel like I make up good stories, but I can definitely critique the ones that are out there. And so that's what I try to do. I'm not, you know, I really feel like the ways in which we understand master narratives about, you know, and how knowledge is produced about the world around us is implicit in the things that we get on a daily basis. So I'm always trying to work with those formal conventions of whatever medium it is, whether it's a
it's a photo, you know, a historical photo archive or a film that already exists or whatever, what have you. So a Hollywood narrative. So I think for my approach is always kind of taking those conventions and trying to deconstruct them.
I continue to find really useful things in Hong En's work. So when I wrote about it at the end of The Gift of Freedom, I was thinking about the idea that, you know, this idea that the gift of freedom that the United States promises is not actually a gift, but a continuation of colonial racial violence and so on and so forth. But as I've moved into the second, this isn't really part of my second project, it's just sort of a leftover thread, which may become something else. In terms of thinking about transition and the timetable and what they're doing, and I'm thinking about it specifically in terms of how the UN and the US use that kind of language around Afghanistan and Iraq to describe their the shift from their military operations from, you know, they say it's a transformation from combat forces, and now they're aid and assist forces, but they're the same people, and, you know, they have the same, you know, defense contractors and all that stuff out there. So, and it's not actually leaving, right? One of the things they're doing, like I said, is that they're building more infrastructure, more permanent infrastructure for drone warfare, which is, of course, about, you know, sending drones across borders into places where we haven't actually formally declared occupation or war or anything like that. So, I came back to it as I was trying to think about the idea of a border as a timeline, a disguise as a timeline. I came back to that piece just because it does so well demonstrate that, you know, the sort of liberal promise, the liberal empire's promise of moving from, you know, here you were in a state of colonial servitude and we will help transition you to independence, just how much of that is a ruse for the continuation of, like, liberal imperial rule. So I continue to appreciate your work. And I'm glad you thought the border as a disguised as a timeline thing made sense, because I totally just made that up this last week. I was like, it thinks it sounds really nice. That's how that
went. I think we have time for just one question. If there's any one last thought or question that some... why don't we just have both of you...
how you characterize the persistence of permanent persistence of colonialism, mm-hmm. and what you call the ruse of liberation, mm-hmm. within decolonial politics. So I was just wondering whether, in your conception of this liberal empire, there is any kind of revolutionary praxis or anti-colonial politics that can leave a mark and change this conception of the permanence of colonialism.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I apologize for this question, but it seems both obvious, but I also think there's some interesting arguments or differences to be had, which is, I was just wondering specifically in Nilita and Hong's work, how you're sort of thinking about spectatorship and the ways in which people, the viewing practices that you're trying to tap into in telling the stories that you tell, and how what even things like the space that you exhibit your work does to shape those questions, and as well as sort of the medium of documentary and how that shapes the work that you produce and the spectators that you're trying to reach. So.
Well, the first thing I would want to say is that, you know, a part of the Cold War premise of U.S. empire was that it was anti-colonial, right? I mean, that was its whole argument for itself was like, that we are anti, you know, we're in this to, we're also an anti-colonial power. This is like this is we want to help you become more independent and give you the gift of freedom and so on and so forth. So, and you know, they did this as an argument against, you know, after supporting the French, then they were supporting national independence right after that in Vietnam. So there's that to consider, that how so often, you know, liberal empire does enfold an anti-colonial language into its practice of war and occupation. I guess I don't necessarily, like, I'm not that good at, like, sort of thinking prescriptively in terms of politically how we can then move on from colonial violence. I obviously want to believe that we can. I'm not quite sure what that would look like. I'm not that good with predictions in terms of knowing what that looks like or being able to really identify what elements are happening. I mean, like, obviously there are people who are fighting, you know, who are, you know, there are all kinds of elements involved in, like, struggling against liberal empire, but it's so huge, it has so many parts. It's got, you know, this wartime apparatus, but, you know, there's also the fact that humanitarianisms are often now married with militarisms, right? So, you know, Doctors Without Borders, any number of NGOs that are involved in, you know, make, you know, negotiate with militaries to go in and do certain kinds of humanitarian aid. So we can think about, you know, how and these things often then perpetuate, you know, the persistence of refugee camps in, for instance, Palestine or in Thailand or wherever, right? So that it's hard for me to see where to name a certain place where we could start to, like, unravel the whole thing, because it's so huge and involves so many different kinds of agencies and so many different kinds of institutions and intuitions about what people are imagined to want.
Audience and spectators. I do think it's really different to create a piece for an installation, because again, I'm always thinking about things as non-linear and in a loop, so that the viewer can enter and leave whenever they want. So that's one consideration. And I think what that does is, it, you know, there's no linear sense of the story, but also that you kind of assume that people aren't going to stay for the whole thing. To be honest, people have very low attention spans when they go into a gallery, and with time-based work, most people are not dedicated to watch the whole thing. So partly it's sort of provoking, for me, if I could just hope to provoke a question about what they're seeing, then I'm happy. That's about what I can expect. But I also feel like my work, I mean, in terms of spectators and how I imagine my audience, you know, my work gets shown in the West. It doesn't get shown anywhere else. So I'm always thinking about that. So it's a kind of weird thing, because actually, you know, my work, I know lots of people in Vietnam, and I have a lot of friends and artist friends in Vietnam, but actually my work is never shown there before. And I think it's because my work is really addressed towards a Western audience, because I'm critiquing very specific narratives that have to do with their position. And so that's always interesting. I always feel like I'm, you know, in some ways, I mean, I don't think I'm trying, I mean, I think it's okay if someone called my work didactic, but I'm not trying to, you know, in some ways, like, I think, I don't know if this is your, an enemy educator, educator enemy, who said that?
That was Bianca Ortiz.
Yes. I feel like kind of an enemy educator in some ways with my work, where I'm, you know, I do have this feel, I do feel like there's a pedagogical mission in some ways, because I am talking about histories that either people don't care about, I try to get the people to care about them, and I'm trying to also make them question what they thought they knew about it already. And so I think with that in mind, am always trying to do something in the work that is calling attention to the viewer's own assumptions. I try to.
Vachani, I guess when I first started making films, I always wanted to be a documentary filmmaker. And it was really because when I was very young and I was very naive, I thought I wanted to change the world, you know. And of course, I don't believe that anymore. I don't think films change the world in any way, what nothing does. But I do think, you know, the way the films are shown, there are two ways, right? It's still the films. Some of them endure. When they endure, they are shown in the classroom now. And I think that's really important because they're taught in globalization, gender studies, trade, you know, I mean, Rujita shows the film in class. And so I feel the ideas, they're being passed on and they're being sustained, and there are other people, other practitioners who's taking off from them. So I'm very happy about that. That's one level where the film has really endured. And the other is that it was used in the grassroots level, where I wasn't involved, because I'm not an activist. But it's used at the grassroots level because in Sri Lanka, even today, the foreign exchange, it's the highest foreign exchange earning, or the second highest now, maybe after the garment workers, is from the remittances of housemaids abroad. And there was no proper training given to the housemaids, and the stories of abuse come and go, but there was nothing at the grassroots level. And now there are a lot of organizations there, and they did use the film. They use the film with the government. They use the film with with some of the trainers. In just in terms of just when women go abroad, to give them another picture that it's not, you're not going to make your fortune in 2 years. You're not going to make all this money and come back and build, this huge house. And there are other problems. You know, families do break up when you're gone. You know, husbands do become alcoholics. Children do drop out of schools. The suicide rates are high. So just to give them a more balanced picture of what to expect. They're still decision making. They're still deciding. But, you know, there's a larger picture. So I think, I know the film has been used at that level, and it's used in classrooms, and, you know, and so, so at some level it's making a difference somewhere, that's what I hope.
So, the really provocative takeaway for me from this panel is the imperative for thinking about minor borders, and really the emergence of minor border studies. The plane that you referenced at the start of the talk, the vanishing plane, is in some ways a kind of allegorical vanishing point of transnational studies, and the ways that geopolitical configurations of culture are consolidated precisely around these border conceptions that are entrenched, that continue to produce these kinds of subjectivities, pathologies of colonialism, apparatus of abuse, that are really based on those kinds of racialized, heteropatriarchal histories that have not gone away. So, you know, thinking about minor border studies is seemingly a very important episteme, a very important one to think through. As borders continue to proliferate, minor borders continue to proliferate, right? And the sort of difference between minor and major borders is a kind of a very important distinction to think through, since we often only focus on major borders that are entrenched in our political imaginary. And these minor borders are the kinds of stories, the kinds of histories and encounters and experiences that have to be accounted for, have to be narrated, they have to be represented as a matter of the vanishing point of our transnational presence. So I want to ask all of you to join me in thanking our panelists and to continue enjoying the rest of our media festival.